Good morning. Welcome to Emmanuel Church this morning. It's good to see you all. Whew. The hardest thing to do sometimes is to give control up to someone else, isn't it? Well, let's stand up and declare this morning that we're going to give our control, the control that we have on our lives, up to the Lord. That's a good feeling.
Yeah. Good morning. You may be seated. Welcome to Emmanuel. My name is Carla, and I'm one of the deacons here. And this is my husband, Nick, who's also one of the deacons. And we're so glad that you've come and joined us for worship this morning, whether you're with us physically, we're so happy to see your faces, or if you're joining us virtually, we're just happy to have you from near and far to worship our King. This morning, if you're here with us physically, we have a connection card. If you wouldn't mind taking that and filling it out with your name, address. If you're a first-time guest, make sure you fill that in because we send you a little something in the mail. And on the bottom, you'll see a place for prayer and praise requests. This is really important. These are cards that we pray over each and every week, and we like to join you in your praises, but we also like to pray over those prayers with you and beside you. If you're watching virtually, there's a link that will be provided for a virtual connection card, and we do look over those as well, so please go ahead and fill that out for us this morning. And I'm going to ask Nick to open us in prayer.
Amen. Promise no dancing today. All right. Good morning, everybody. I'm just going to go ahead and open us up in prayer. Lord, thank you for allowing us to all be able to come together again today. Lord, we know that these times we are facing uncertain things. We have schools trying to start back up, people still looking for work, people having trouble at work. But we also need to remember that during these tribulations that we face, no matter what they are, that you are going to be our constant, that you are going to be the same. You're the same yesterday, that you are the same today. You'll be the same tomorrow forever. And Lord, we know that we will be able to cast our anxieties on you because, you know, we know that today will bring its own worries and that we must not worry about tomorrow, for that is for you to handle. And Lord, just please be with us as we go throughout this week and just help us to live life more humbly and live it for your will. In your name, amen.
Amen. You know, as we continue our walk as fully developing followers of Jesus Christ, I think the most important thing we can ever do is spend time in God's Word, listening to Him, reading what He says. And I say that, and yet I let everything else get in the way of that. I let running and constantly doing get in the way every day, and then I go, wow, I haven't spent time with the Lord in days. And that's sad to say. Maybe some of you have the same struggle. Let me just encourage you today that the most important thing you can do in developing your walk with Him and encouraging your heart and making you a better servant and minister to others is to sit with Him alone. Open His Word. Read it. I'd even encourage you to read it out loud. Then it goes in your ears, too, and goes in your hearing that way. Spend time with Him. Read His Word. Let Him speak to you. It's the most powerful thing you can do, and you watch what He does in your life. You watch and see. Let's stand up and sing. Speak. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. It's okay to dance in the song, okay? Just telling you. Word of life, speak to my weary heart, strengthen my broken parts, lead me to your open arms. Word of truth, illuminate all these lies, the enemy speaks inside, and in freedom I will rise. Come on. You call me out from the grave, so I can live like I've been changed. There is a new song in my soul, Spirit of God, take me to a deeper place, take me and I'm what it says, I will not be afraid. Spirit of God, fill me with joy again, springing up from within, can I be contained? You call me out from the grave, so I can live like I've been changed. There is a new song in my soul, seated.
Good morning, Emmanuel. Man, it is so good to be with you this morning here on campus and online. You guys sound good today. Some of y'all were dancing a little bit now. You know, if you move both feet at the same time, you know, that's wrong. I'm just saying. So, man, some of you grew up in old traditions where, I think I'm one. Am I not one? There you go. Some of us grew up in the old traditions where, you know, we weren't allowed to dance, we weren't allowed to play cards, we weren't allowed to have fun. Aren't you glad where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty? Amen? So some of y'all understood that. So good to be with you guys this morning. Before we begin today, I want to make sure that we pray for our dear friends down in Puerto Rico as well as in Haiti. As you know, two named storms moving through that region. They're expecting over a foot of rain in the Manabal area where we serve, and so we want to pray for our friends in the Dominican Republic, and we also do amazing work down in Haiti, so we want to be mindful of them today. And many of you know that our son Josh started school in Louisiana last week, and so nothing says welcome to Louisiana like two hurricanes moving into the Gulf. So he's starting in Louisiana this week, and he's going to be going to school in Chicago next week, I'm afraid, so as it blows him up the river. So we want to be a prayer for those and ask God to protect them. And ask God to bless those ministry sites that where we serve. Father God, we're thankful for the day, Lord, and we ask that you just keep your hedge protection around our dear friends. Lord, not only in Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, and Haiti, Lord, but all in the Gulf region, Father, we just pray your protection upon them. Lord, thank you for the day. Thank you for what you're going to do in our midst today. We're thankful for your word. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to welcome you back to our summer series, 2020 Healthy Vision. This is where we're talking about in discovering the five habits of healthy followers of Christ and five habits of a healthy church. Now, let me remind you of what we've already discovered so far. So first of all, we talked about how we grow stronger through worship. And the reason for that is we set aside our differences and our diversities. We set aside those things that we disagree on, and we come together and we worship the one true God. And so we grow stronger through worship. Number two, we learn that we also grow larger through evangelism. So we begin to reach out and bring more people into the faith, and the ministry and our lives grow larger. Now today I want to talk about this. I want to talk about how we grow deeper through spiritual growth. Deeper through spiritual growth. Now, listen, we do not want to be those Christians, those believers in God, who simply make a decision to follow Christ and nothing more. We don't want to be those Christians who check the box, reserve a place in heaven, get out of hell, and then live the rest of our lives the way we want to. We don't want to be that type of Christian because we know that that will not bring satisfaction and fulfillment. Nor do we want to be a church that is 500 members broad or wide and only 2 inches deep. We should not be the church that is church light, church easy, church just come in and kind of do your own thing and leave without any life transformation. We want to be the people of God that are putting our roots down deep in the truth of God's word and being transformed, changed into the image of Jesus Christ. Jeff Stoltz was here with us last week, and man, I tried to buy a leather vest, but I couldn't find one my size, and so this is the best I could come up with this week. But man, Jeff was amazing. He set this message up perfectly because he reminded us that many people make a decision to follow Christ, but then they miss the process of spiritual growth and development. This process is called discipleship or spiritual growth. Now, how many of you know that healthy things grow? Healthy things grow. Healthy plants grow. Healthy businesses grow. Healthy churches grow. Healthy followers of Christ grow. Listen, we are supposed to mature in our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we could really finish with just one verse. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want you to listen carefully to what the Apostle Paul wrote. Listen to these words found in Romans chapter 8, verses 14 and 16. The Bible says, this is what Paul wrote, for all who were led by the Spirit of God, that's the Holy Spirit, are sons of God or children of God. And so we should not be like cringing, fearful slaves, but we should behave like God's very own children, adopted into the bosom of his family and calling him Father, Father, for his Holy Spirit speaks to us deep in our hearts and tells us that we are really God's children. Listen, the Bible teaches us that you and I, as followers of Jesus Christ, are the children of God. We are the family of God. And the Word of God also teaches us that I'm bouncing for some reason, guys. I'm not sure what's going on. Is it me? What's that? Grab this one. All right, you're going to kill this one for me? Is that better?
Is that better? There it is. All right, so. Man, nothing worse with Elvis with a mic. Amen. That sounds a little bit better. We'll go with that. Listen, so we are God's children, the Bible says, but not only are we God's children, but the Word of God says that we're supposed to act like the children of God. How many of you have children or grandchildren? How many of you like them? We lost 7 hands right there. There you go. All right, listen, they belong to us, and we want our children to act like they have some sense, right? Well, God's word says the same thing. We are God's children and we should act like it. Let me just share this with you. There is tremendous benefit in growing in our faith relationship with God, and there's tremendous danger if we do not. So let's consider today the protective nature and benefit of spiritual growth. Now, if you have your Bibles or if you're online and you'd like to go ahead and take a look at your own Bible, see Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16 today. Now, the Bible says this in verse 11. Now, these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and pastors and teachers. Verse 12. Their responsibility, their job, their role is to train or to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. That is the church. This will continue, Paul writes. This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up. Here's the standard, to the full and complete standard of Christ. And that's Ephesians 4, 11 through 13. So the Bible teaches us that spiritual leaders are called to equip or to train God's people. Well, who are these people? Well, the Bible identifies them. They're apostles. It certainly would include the 12, certainly would include the Apostle Paul. It also refers to prophets. Now, prophets are not those people who foretell the future and try to explain what's going to happen in the future. Prophets were those who would stand boldly and proclaim the truth of God's word without hesitation, without apology. They were the ones who were preaching and teaching the word of God accurately, no matter what they suffered as a result. The Bible also identifies evangelists, and we would refer to them today as missionaries, those who would travel around the corner, around the world, telling other people about Jesus Christ. Jeff, last week, we would consider him to be an evangelist. And then the Word of God says that there are pastors and teachers, probably better put pastors, teachers, because that is the shepherding role of the local ministers or the local elders in the church. Now, what is their job? What is their role? The Apostle Paul said it is to train or equip. Now, that is a really interesting word. It literally means, it's a nautical term, it's a fisherman's term. It literally means to mend or restore the broken nets for proper use. And so here's what would happen. The fishermen would go out at night and they would fish all night and they would pull the nets in over and over and over again. And they would take their fish to the market, but during the day, they would have to mend the nets so that they were prepared to be used again that night so that the fish could be caught. Listen, that's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be those of us that have been placed in the church as spiritual coaches or leaders. It is our job to mend and prepare you so that God can use you in the harvest. So does that make sense? And so we're really nothing more than spiritual coaches. What is our job? Well, to equip the believers and followers to do some things. Number one, to minister to others. Listen, our job, our role is to equip you, to minister to you, to prepare you so that you can go out and minister to others. Number two, to enjoy the unity of the faith. Listen, our goal is, our job is to make sure that we're focusing on the main things, keeping the main things, so that we can enjoy the unity of our faith. Number three, to learn more and more about Jesus. That's important. Janet was talking about it today, about getting in the Word of God and learning more and more about Him. Our goal, our job is to train and equip the church so that we can learn more about Jesus. And then number four, to become more like Him. That is maturing in our faith. Now listen, spiritual maturity, the term spiritual maturity, is a relative term, not an absolute term. Now, this is important. It's a relative term, not an absolute term. What do I mean by that? Now, if we were to say today, we are a spiritually mature group, that would be a lie. That's an absolute statement. We are spiritually mature. We have no further to go. We have arrived. The Bible doesn't teach spiritual maturity as a destination, but it's a process. And so it is a relative term. So watch this. We should be more spiritually alive today, more mature, more grown up today than we were yesterday. If we were to take a snapshot of who we are pre-COVID, just in the beginning of the month of March, and then we took a picture of who we are now, there should be a radical difference. There should be growth involved. Just a few minutes ago, one of the families came in, and I tell you, their son must have grown a foot in just 1 week. Listen, that should be that noticeable even in our own lives spiritually. We should see the spiritual growth and development in our lives. And so it is a relative term, not an absolute term. So here at Emmanuel, we say that we should become fully developing followers of Jesus Christ, not fully developed followers of Jesus Christ. Listen, there are a lot of people, nobody goes here at this church, but people outside of this church believe this, that they think that they can arrive at a plateau spiritually and they're fine. Listen, when you are done growing, you, my friend, are dead and you're in the presence of God. And so we should grow every day of our life until He takes us home. Listen, this is what the Bible says in verse 14. Then, if we follow the leadership, if we continue to grow in our relationship with Christ, if we do the things that God has called us to do, the Bible says, then we will no longer be immature like children, literally those who can't even talk, babies, opposite of mature. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with their lies so clever they sound like truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Jesus Christ, who is the head of the body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly as each part does its own special work. It helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. I want you to notice the word then for just a moment. Then. If we commit to spiritual growth, if we begin to do this, the benefits of spiritual growth begin to take place. Listen, spiritual growth is not automatic. Well, what do we mean by that? The moment you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you were moved from death to life, from darkness to light. Your name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You had a place prepared for you in heaven. All of your sins were forgiven. You were flooded with grace and mercy and all of the goodness of God. Like 70 different things took place the moment you said yes to Jesus Christ. But one thing that didn't take place the moment you accepted Christ was spiritual maturity. The Bible teaches that when we say yes to Christ, we become like infants, like children, and we have to learn to walk and talk and move, and we develop in our relationship with Christ. And so it's not automatic. And let me just share this with you. It has nothing to do with your age. It has nothing to do with your age. We have a lot of young people in this second service, which I love. Listen, there are a lot of old Christians who are spiritually immature. Matter of fact, I'm going to be careful with this, but there are some people who have lived their lives as Christians for a long, long time, 30, 40, 50, maybe even 60 years, and I've been in ministry long enough and in church all my life. Listen, some of the people who claim to be Christians all their lives or most of their life are some of the meanest junkyard dogs I've ever met. So it has nothing to do with age or how long you've been a Christian. There are people who say, oh, I was saved when I was 8 years old. And you're 80 and you're still acting like that? Wow. So it has nothing to do with age or how long you've been a Christian. See, salvation is an event and spiritual maturity is a process. Just like when you were born, that was an event. You came into this world at a moment in time. And then it began the process of the rest of your life. And this process is what we're defining today as spiritual development. Or growth. Listen, wouldn't it be great to be able to go to the gym one time and then look like Nick who prayed for us today? Man, if you could just go to the gym once, do whatever Nick does once and walk out looking like him forever, man, you sign me up, I'll pay that gym membership. But we know that getting physically fit is a process, it's not an event, right? Well, listen, our spiritual development is the same thing. It's not just a one-time deal. It's a process that takes place over the course of a lifetime. When our son Joshua was little, he first started playing flag football. Like most of your kids, if they play football at all, they probably started in flag football. Well, I took him to practice one night, and then the next night I was taking him to practice, and he called me Dada then. He said, Dada. He said, where are we going? I said, we're going to Mount Harmony. He said, why are we going there? I said, I'm taking you to football practice. He said, why? I said, so you can learn how to play football. He said, I did that last night. Yeah, you probably need to learn a little bit more. Listen, as Christians, we need to keep the process of spiritual growth and development going the rest of our lives. I want you to listen carefully to this. Spiritual growth and development has a protective nature, protective measure that is so important for us. There are three benefits of us growing spiritually and three dangers if we don't. Let me share them with you quickly. Number one. Spiritual growth or development will help us from being tossed about by every wind of new teaching, which is the Word of God. The term tossed about there is a nautical term. It means to be tossed or by the waves and beaten by the surf. Have you ever gone to the beach and gotten knocked over by the waves? I mean, about a month or so ago, Lisa and I took a day trip down to Ocean City, and we went to, I guess it was Assateague or Chincoteague, whichever beach that is. And man, it was a hot day, and right before we left, I said, oh, I'm going to go out one more time, and I got out in the waves, and I love it. You know, I was thinking I was 16 again, and man, the waves are splashing over, and all of a sudden, this big wave came over, and I said, Jesus, this would be a good time for you to come back right now, because this is going to kill me. And all of a sudden, man, the wave washed over, and first time in years, man, it took me off my feet, spun me around in the water, hit my shoulder on the sand underneath, and I popped back up, and I looked on the shore, and Lisa was laughing. And so I walked back, and I was trying to be cool, right, pulling up my britches, you know, I'm trying to be cool, and I walked out, and Lisa said, you should have seen it, Rick. She said, there are like 7 or 8 of you guys standing there at the wave, and when that wave came, it took all of you out. Isn't that funny? Hilarious. Listen, the Bible says if we don't grow spiritually, we're going to be tossed about just like we were in the waves that day. Metaphorically speaking, it talks about being agitated mentally or emotionally, disturbed, overtaken by by what appears to be truth. We're going to be disillusioned, pounded by waves, and just tossed about. Lisa and I took a day trip yesterday and went over to Great Falls, Virginia. And if you've never been there, it's worth a day trip. It's just amazing to see the water. And you can walk down and climb down the rocks, and you can literally get right there at the edge of the water. And it's powerful looking up, watching the Potomac River cascade over the rocks, and just that pounding sound. And it was interesting just looking at the debris that was down at the bottom in the pools, just being turned around and around and around and around, and all of the foam that was worked up against the rocks because of the agitation of the waterfall. Listen, the Bible says if we don't grow spiritually, if we don't commit ourselves to the task of growing up in the Lord, we're going to be just like the debris in the water yesterday. Just tossed about and spun around and foaming at both ends. And then the Bible says this. If we don't grow spiritually, we're going to be blown around by every new teaching. Spun around in circles with no stopping whatsoever. We were pretty fortunate just the past couple weeks ago when the hurricane came through, the tropical storm came through, and the tornado touched down. And some of you experienced that. Some of our members experienced severe damage to their homes. But if you've ever been in a tornado or have ever seen it, you know what it does. It just spins so viciously, and it seems like it'll never stop. And the sound is unforgettable. And it just picks up the debris that's around and just throws it all over the place. And it leaves a path of destruction like nothing else. And the Bible says, listen, if we don't grow spiritually, we're going to be blown around by every wind of doctrine or teaching. You know, for years, we thought the blowing and the tossing referred to the different philosophies or philosophers and religious nuts and quacks. You know, those who name it and claim it, blab it and grab it. Those who tell us to put $1,000 on our credit card to plant a seed so they can get rich. You know those guys. Those are false teachers. Don't waste your time with them. These are the ones who prey on the unstable and the undeveloped. Those are the ones who send countless requests for money to our seniors, who are sending them money over and over and over again. But I'm here to tell you today that our greatest danger are not the cults, and they're not the religious nuts and the quacks. We used to be afraid of not growing in our relationship with Christ, or we would become a Mormon, or maybe a Jehovah's Witness, or maybe we would be picked up by a van and taken out somewhere out west, and we would be made to be a part of a cult. We were so afraid of not growing in our spiritual lives because we were afraid to become one of them. But listen, my friends, I don't believe that it's reserved exclusively for the religious quacks and the cults and the groups that may want to take us down the wrong path. I believe our culture has become a louder voice than any of the religious groups known to man. The world and our culture is screaming out to us, teaching us what is wrong and what is right. Listen, our culture is challenging what God says about love and life and fulfillment and purpose. We don't have to be so concerned about being dragged out west. We need to be concerned about the culture that influences our thinking. Listen, today in our society, tell me if this is not true. Right is wrong and wrong is right. It's just bizarre. I mean, we watch the news, we read the papers, we read the blogs, and we scratch our head and we're thinking, what in the world is going on? We are so distant and removed from God. Listen, this is not new. In Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20, God says, woe or doom to those who call evil good and good evil, and exchange darkness for light and light for darkness. Listen, this is happening before our own eyes. Our culture is teaching those things that God says is evil, and the culture is saying, no, they're good. And what our culture is saying is good. God's word says that's out of bounds. Listen, if we are not growing spiritually, if we're not putting our roots down deep in the word of God and developing our own spiritual lives, we will be tossed about and blown around. Micah chapter 3, verses 1 and 4. The Bible says, listen, you leaders of Jacob, you rulers of the nation of Israel, speaking specifically to the rulers of God's children. He says, you ought to know what is just, but you hate what is good. and you love what is evil. And in verses 2 and 3, it talks about how they unfairly treated God's people. And then verse 4, someday these sinners, these leaders who have turned the world upside down with their lives will cry out to the Lord for help, but he will not answer them. He will hide his face from them at that time because they have done such wicked deeds. Listen, if we are not growing spiritually, if we are not developing our personal relationship with Jesus Christ, we will be tossed around, we will be blown away, and we will be deceived by lies. Notice what the Bible says. We will not be influenced by people who try to trick us with their lies, so clever they sound like the truth. In the New English Translation, the Word of God, that verse says, carried about by every wind of teaching, by the trickery, by the sleight of hand, who craftily carry out their deceit, their deceitful schemes. The King James simply puts it this way. They lie in wait to deceive. It's amazing, isn't it? That there are people out in the world, outside of the faith, who are deliberately trying to tear us down, trying to bring us down, trying to teach us that what the Word of God says is evil. No, that's good. What the Word of God says is wrong. No, this is the way things are now. And we see it over and over and over again. We see it in our families. We see it in our workplace. We see it in our schools. We see it in our communities. We see it everywhere we go. There's a deliberate planning or system. We get the word method from that very thought. Listen, spiritual growth will keep us from falling to those who exchange the truth for a lie, and will keep us grounded in the war on truth. There is a protective nature in growing up spiritually. There is a huge benefit, and there's a huge warning for those of us who choose not to. Listen, you have to choose. You have to choose whether you're going to grow in your faith or you're just going to coast. You have to choose. Am I going to get in the Word? Am I going to pray? Am I going to be actively involved in church? Am I going to give up my time, my talents, and my treasures? Am I going to be all in for God, or am I just going to play church? You have to choose. Listen, and if you choose to do the right thing, if you choose to grow up, then you're not going to be tossed about. You're not going to be blown away. You're not going to be deceived by the lies of our culture, because that's what spiritual growth does. It protects us from that. But if you choose not to develop your faith, my friends, you should expect the worst, because you will be tossed about. You will be blown around. And unfortunately, you're going to be deceived by the lies of our culture. Let me finish up quickly. Spiritual growth also makes us more like Jesus Christ. A little bit more positive than the first part of the message. Look at verse 15. The Bible says, instead we will speak the truth in love. I'm going to come back to that in just a moment. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way, more and more like Jesus, who is the head of the body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly as each part does its own special work. It helps the other parts grow so that the whole body, the church, is healthy and growing and full of love. Listen, number one, Jesus is the source of our spiritual growth. He is the head of the body. Remember where it says there, we will speak the truth in love? Literally, it means truthing in love. What does that mean? Truthing in love. In other words, our lives begin to reflect the nature and the character of Christ by what we think, by what we say, and by what we do. Listen, as we continue to grow spiritually, all of a sudden we begin to speak, think spiritual thoughts. We don't get engaged in the stinking thinking. We don't have thoughts that are opposed and opposite to God. We begin thinking like Christ. We have the mind of Christ, Paul says. And then out of that heart, out of that fountain, we begin speaking the truths of God. Now, I'm not talking about walking around quoting scripture every day. I'm not talking about that. That'd be a little weird. But I'm talking about our words are full of grace and mercy and love and compassion. And then the things that we do, the activities that we're involved in, both publicly and privately, begin to reflect the nature of Christ. But not only is Jesus the source of our spiritual growth, but he's also the target or the model of our spiritual growth. Notice what Paul writes, growing in every way more and more like Christ. Listen, we all have spiritual heroes. We all have people in our lives that we value and we love and we admire. But listen, your spiritual hero would say, listen, don't model your life after me. Model your life after Christ. Listen, we all have flaws and shortcomings, and we make mistakes, and we fail, and we fall. We all do that. But the Word of God teaches us that Jesus Christ is our model. We should look more like Jesus today than we did yesterday, and we should look more like Jesus tomorrow than we do today. Listen to what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 3:18. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, listen to this, don't miss this, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. The King James says, from glory to glory. Now watch this. And so we begin our week, Sunday. Here I am, I'm reflecting the image of Christ. But as I spiritually mature on Monday, I'm more and more like Jesus Christ from glory to glory. And then on Tuesday, I wake up and I'm a little bit more like Jesus on Tuesday than I was on Sunday and Monday from glory to glory to glory. And then I wake up on Wednesday and I'm a little bit more like Christ because I'm committed to the process of growing spiritually. And so from glory to glory to glory to glory, did you get it? Listen, every single day we should look more and more like Jesus Christ. We just move closer and closer to Him, and don't miss this, and further from the world. Well, how do we do that? Very quickly, personally, we do it through worship, where we show and demonstrate our appreciation to God for who He is and what He's said and what He's done and what He's promised to do. We do it through the Word of God, as Janet was talking about, not only reading the Word of God, but allowing the Word of God to actually be disciplined and acted out in our lives. Spending time in prayer every single day, the stewardship of our time, giving of our time and our talents, our abilities, and even our financial resources to the Lord, honoring Him with that, and then certainly the fellowship of one another. And I think that's one of the greatest damages that COVID-19 has created in the church. It has separated our fellowship, and we so desperately, desperately need one another. I'm so thankful that the church is almost full today. But as a church, we also have a process where we want you to grow spiritually. And so we have the 101 classes, 201, 301, 401, where we want you to be involved in the church. We want you to become a member 101. We want to teach you how to mature in your relationship with Christ. That's 201. We want to teach you how God has shaped you for ministry so that you can be involved in the kingdom's work. And that's 301. And then in 401, we want to teach you how to be on mission every single day for God, both here at home and around the world. So we have a process we use with the connection groups and worship services and Celebrate Recovery Ministries and all the other ministries that we have in our church. And so you have personal opportunities and corporate opportunities to develop your relationship with Christ. But like going to a buffet, you got to figure out if you're going to eat or not. We can set it out on the table. We can teach you what to do and how to do it. But unless you choose to grow spiritually, it'll never happen in your life. Let me close with this. One of the most beautiful stories found in the Word of God, and it's John chapter 3, and it begins with verse 23. At this time, the Bible says, John the Baptist was baptizing at Aenon, near Salim, because there was plenty of water there, the Bible says, and people kept coming to him for baptism. Now, this was before John the Baptist was thrown into prison. A debate broke out between John's disciples, his followers, and a certain Jew over ceremonial cleansing. So John's disciples, I love this, John's disciples came to John and said to him, Rabbi, teacher, the man you met on the other side of the Jordan River, the one you identify as the Messiah, Jesus Christ, he is also baptizing people. And everybody, don't you laugh, everybody is going to him instead of us. Jerk. I can't believe that. Why aren't they coming to us? We're baptizing. We've been here. We're doing our thing. We know how to baptize. We're teaching the Word of God. Why aren't they coming to us? John replied, no one can receive anything unless God gives it from heaven. You yourselves know how plainly I told you, I am not the Messiah. I am only here to prepare the way for Him. And then he gives this beautiful illustration. He said, it is the bridegroom. It's the groom who marries the bride. And the bridegroom's friend is simply glad to stand with him and hear his vows. Therefore, he writes, he said, I am filled with joy at Jesus' success. And then here's the verse. He said to his friends, he said, see, guys, he must become greater and greater, and I must become less and less. That's the picture of spiritual growth and development. Less of you, less of me, and more of Jesus. Less of the world, and more of God. Today, tomorrow, and the next day. When you dedicate yourself to spiritual growth, you become more like Him and less like yourself. So if you have made the decision to become a follower of Jesus Christ, I'm going to encourage you today to commit to the process of growing up in Him. There are benefits. It will keep you from being tossed about, blown around, and deceived by lies. It will make you more like Jesus, and it will keep you out of a whole lot of trouble. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your truth. God, I pray today with all of my heart, Lord, that those of us who have made a decision to say yes to Jesus Christ by faith, Lord, would also commit to the process of growing to be more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ. God, it is dangerous. God, it is so dangerous, so destructive, Lord, to simply mark the box, reserve your place in heaven, stay out of hell, and then suffer through this life, never growing up. God, I pray today that each of us in this room and those watching online today would be as committed as we possibly can to growing our spiritual faith, to go to the spiritual gym every day and do whatever it takes to grow, to be a part of a vibrant church that preaches and teaches the Word of God and loves one another and serves the community and reaches around the world. It might be Emmanuel, it might be somewhere else. That's not really that important. But somewhere where Christ is honored, the word is caught, and the world is changed because of the love of Jesus. I'm going to ask you, as you're seated today with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, just you and the Lord, those watching, if you are a follower of Christ, if you are a believer, would you take this next step? I will take the personal steps necessary to grow in my faith, whatever it takes. If I have to get up earlier to read the Word of God and pray, I'll do it. If I need to make sure that I understand that my time and my talents, my treasures, the things that I call my own, if I need to give those to the Lord, if I need to surrender those to the Lord, I'll do that, whatever it takes. If it means committing to coming to church every Sunday and not just when I feel like it, would you take that personal step necessary to grow your faith? Secondly, would you consider participating in Emmanuel's process, becoming a fully developing follower of Jesus Christ? For 6 months, we've shut our spiritual growth track down because we didn't know how to do it safely. We're figuring it out. Starting in September, we're going to have 101. So if you're looking to be a member of the church, we're going to have that opportunity for you to teach, to come and be a part of 101 so that we can teach you how become a member of the church. More importantly, we want to talk about your relationship with God. If you've already taken 101 but have never taken 201, where we talk about how do you grow in your faith, we want you to be involved in 201, 301 ministry, 401 missions. We're still trying to figure out how to do connection groups for the fall safely. We want you to be involved. Would you commit to that process of growing your faith and becoming more and more like Jesus? Brothers and sisters, would you pray for just a moment? And if you were here today or you're watching, and you said, Brother Rick, you've been talking about growing our faith. I don't have a faith yet. Maybe you understand and realize today that there's never been a time in your life where you made a personal decision to say yes to Jesus by faith. You don't have to live like that a second longer. Today, right where you are, you can pray and ask Jesus into your life. You can surrender your life to Him. You can cross the finish line and give yourself to Him and invite Him into your life. Would you pray something like this? Father God, right now I don't think I'm in right relationship with you. I've never said yes to you. So the best way I know how right now, I'm asking Jesus to come into my life. I believe that He's your Son. I believe that He's God. I believe that. So God, I need you to forgive me of every sin, every mistake I've ever made. And I want you to be my God, and I'll be your follower from here on out. And God, not only do I commit my life to you, but I commit to the process of growing spiritually. I don't want to be a 40-year-old baby. I want to grow. So God, I commit to that process as well. Father, we're thankful for the decisions and the commitments made. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. In just a moment, we're going to be dismissed and we're going to head out the door. Don't forget, we are now receiving the offering through just dropping your offering envelopes in the basket. Many of you give online, so thank you for doing that so faithfully. If you are a guest with us today, please, please understand, this is our responsibility. We do not ask that you give financially. We're just glad that you're here. As you walk out the door, don't put an offering envelope in the basket. Just drop your connection card with your name and contact information on that. Let us know how we can pray with you and for you, and that will be offering enough. If you're watching online and you'd like to participate in the offering and support the ministry here at Emmanuel financially, go to our website, www.emmanuelchurch.tv. On the front page, you see a box that says Ways to Give. Click on that, and it lists ways that you can support us financially. We appreciate all that are doing so faithfully. Hey, before we get out of here, let me just share a couple really important announcements. Number one, on Labor Day weekend, on September 6th, we will not have two services that day, and Lord willing, weather permitting, we are not going to be meeting inside. We're going to have one service on Sunday morning. It's going to be outside at 10 o'clock, and so the refreshment tent's going to be set up about 9:30, so you can come and get something cold to drink or something hot. Now, the elders promised me, Al promised me, that it's going to be 72.5 degrees, partly sunny, with a breeze coming out of the north, not a drop of humidity. No pressure, Al, no pressure whatsoever, but it's going to be a beautiful day, and if it does rain, we'll just move everything in here. But bring your lawn chair, bring your family, ask people who haven't come. I mean, we can spread out as far as from here to Solomon's Island. We'll just stretch out. I'll be as loud as I possibly need to be. We're going to have a great time. Our children will be with us, so no Envision Kids that day. Our middle school and high school will also join us. It is going to be a great time of celebration. And then, finally, on September 13th, we are really excited to launch this. We are going to relaunch our infant through pre-K ministry for Envision Kids. We figured out how to do it safely. Our numbers are low enough that we can make sure that we come under the governor's guidelines on the number of children per room. And so if you have children that are infants through pre-K and then kindergarten through fifth grade, Envision Kids ministry will be full-blown, wide open, starting at the 10:45 service. Now listen carefully. The 9 o'clock service will be family-oriented. So if you come at the 9 o'clock service, you bring your children in here. We're going to have a great time. And then at 10:45 only, we'll have Envision Kids. And that actually started today. And so we're excited about that opportunity. So families can worship together at 9, and then kids can go to Envision Kids at 10:45. We want to minister to you and your family where you need it most. And we're excited about doing that. Hey, let's go ahead and stand over our feet. I don't know why you want to do this. It is cool in here, and it is hot, hot, hot outside. But listen, there's a world out there that needs you to grow. There's a world out there that needs you to be at your very best spiritually. Your family needs you to be at your best. Your community needs you to be at the best, at your best. And the only way we can do that is to be a little bit more like Jesus tomorrow than we are today, a little bit more like Him on Tuesday than we are tomorrow. Listen, Emmanuel. The world needs us to be on our game, to grow spiritually, and to be like Him. So let's say it together, Emmanuel. Emmanuel, let's go be the church. God bless you. Have a great week.